Hi, everyone. I'm Colleen Cosmo Murphy from Classic Album Sundays, and welcome to our first event with Venus Unwrapped here at King's Place. We're so excited to be here. Just a few things, a few house rules. We are going to be playing music tonight on vinyl, I know, an entire album and also selections from another album. When the music is in play, I just ask that you refrain from conversation, that you just sit, close your eyes, and really give yourself over to the music so you can truly experience it as in deep a way as possible. I should also remind you to please put your phones on silent. So if you haven't yet, please do that now. So Dusty Springfield, she was the most iconic British female musician throughout the swinging 60s. But her popularity wasn't anchored only in the UK. At one point, she was the best-selling female singer in the world. And after the Beatles, she was the second British invasion act to land a US hit. She was not only an icon, but also an iconoclast, both in her personal life and her professional life, and she really paved the way for so many modern English-British soul singers. She exercised a level of control over her work that other females of her time could only dream of. And she was also a feminist and a civil rights activist, more by example rather than by word. In order to get ahead, she had to be tough, outspoken, and composed, but she was really shy, vulnerable, and often internally breaking at the seams. And of course, she faced many more challenges than her male counterparts. Dusty was a woman ahead of her time. And tonight, we're going to take a nice in-depth look at and an in-depth listen to her classic album, one that's celebrating 50 years today, on this year, Dusty in Memphis. Joining me is another British soul diva, another legend whose career took off meteorically 20 years after the release of Dusty in Memphis. And along with Dusty Springfield, I feel she also helped pave the way for other soul singers like Amy Winehouse and Adele. When our special guest debut album came out in 1989, both the album and its singles, All Around the World, topped charts all around the world, believe it or not. And the album went triple platinum in the UK and earned our guests nominations for 4 Brit Awards and 2 Grammy Award nominations. Please give a warm welcome to Lisa Stansfield.
Hello.
So thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
2 major album anniversaries, both Dusty's album, Dusty in Memphis, is 50 years old, and Affection is 30 years old. I just can't even believe it.
A long, long time.
Yes.
Yeah.
Very long time.
I sort of sometimes don't want to think about how long. It was a nice time.
Well, we'll get to that after we talk about Dusty and listen to Dusty. So tell us, how did you first hear about Dusty Springfield?
I'd always been aware of Dusty Springfield through my childhood. I was born 66 and this album came out in 69. So it was always permeating through everything, really. She was always there. And it's just a beautiful sound that you hear. And it didn't really make sense until I started singing in the clubs and I'd started to sing maybe 1 or 2 of her old songs. And so I went, that's who it is. And it all made sense. The jigsaw all fit together, yeah.
Well, the thing that's so wonderful about Dusty's singing is that it seems so effortless. And I think... For many of us, we don't know how much work really goes into this and the kind of the level that she was at as a singer.
Yeah.
As a singer yourself, can you kind of talk us through this?
Ooh. Well, when I found out that I was doing this, when I agreed to do it, and I loved this album and I'd not heard it for a really long time. And so I put it on in the front room and I thought, I'm going to sing it. I'm going to just sing it. And I did sing it, but it was fucking really hard. It was like one of the... And she makes it sound as if... I mean, I said to you before, it's like she's doing a little Trump or something. And she's just effortless. And it is unbelievable the amount of breath control that she had. And I mean, I think a lot of pop singers, as a pop singer, you get a bit pissed off because people don't regard you as a real singer. You know, and I do. I sing properly. I sing from my diaphragm. And also as a pop singer, you sort of, you do nasty things to your voice as well, you know, to get that sound. Mm-hmm. And she just had incredible control. Unbelievable control.
Well, she was trailblazing in so many ways. And obviously, you know, I was talking before, she was a civil rights activist. I mean, she really helped break African-American music here in the UK. When she was hosting Ready, Steady, Go, yeah. She had the Motown special, had the Temptations on, Martha Reeves, the Miracles, young Stevie Wonder as well. She also had Jimi Hendrix. She played with Jimi Hendrix. She had Jimi Hendrix on her show. And she also, another interesting story too, she was doing a tour in South Africa and she actually left the tour because the audiences were all white and she had been promised they were going to be integrated. So she was really ahead of her time. Also, she was either gay or bisexual. I'm not quite sure exactly. She had mainly relationships with women. But she actually came out in the press in the late 60s in an article with the Evening Standard. And she said she liked girls as much as she liked boys. And it wasn't like massive headlines. And you'd think it maybe at that time it would have been. But she was quite vocal about it.
Well, that just shows you how her voice overrode everything, really. Because that's what people wanted to listen to, wanted to know about. So that was just an irrelevance, really, I think.
I think so. Yeah. I mean, she was trailblazing in these ways, very ahead of her times. But how about as an artist?
The way that she saw the cool in a lot of other artists, you know, that other people didn't. You know, she got Led Zeppelin signed.
Yep.
She just saw it, and she was very innovative as a, you know, looking at things, and she knew this is going to be big. This is going to be big. She was amazing, actually, like that. Mm. Yeah, she could spot talent, really could.
And she was also, before Dusty in Memphis, she actually produced herself, but she didn't tell anybody.
Yeah, she did that, the album before that. Yeah.
Like she'd have Johnny France, who was as listed as producer, but she was actually the one directing the musicians,
right?
Because she had a massive record collection. She was obsessed with music. She listened to all different types of music, and she was a real fan. She was a real fan, absolutely. And so she could direct the musicians and say to the bass player who's playing stand up bass, okay, I want you to play a Motown bass riff. And she was telling these musicians what to do, but she still didn't take credit as a producer.
It's great. But also, I wonder in those days, was it just unheard of as a woman to produce something?
Absolutely.
Which is now, it's just, you know, you just do it. Everyone does it.
It was quite rare. I think she had a great quote about it. She said, about Johnny France, she said, for one, he deserved to get the credit, and I was grateful. Yeah. And then there was a calculating part of me that thought it looked too slick for me to produce and sing, because women didn't do that.
Oh.
And there remains in the British audience, though less so, that attitude of, don't get too slick on us, don't be too smart, or we won't love you, and I wanted to be loved.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
she could have been anything she wanted to be, really.
Absolutely.
And I felt there was a lot of people have said it about that there was a mask because the face was always very heavily made up. And whether that was something to do with the sexuality thing at the time, I have no idea. But it was like she was a very, very shy person and almost like she was hiding behind this cloak of makeup. Because I've met people who knew her and said she was incredibly shy, but there was just a real thing about her.
Yeah, it's interesting because she had three different television shows, all with like Dusty, decidedly Dusty, it must be Dusty.
Right, right.
And she, when you hear about her as a person and how vulnerable she was, it's kind of surprising that she did so much television. I mean, you do television and movies yourself. I mean, what's it like? Is it a whole different side to you?
Strange. I mean, doing stuff like that is so far removed from what your whole purpose in life is.
Right.
You know, it's like something that you need to do sometimes.
Yeah.
But I could imagine that she suffered quite a lot because it is quite unforgiving. Some TV.
I'm sure. Yeah. It must be really brutal. Now, in some ways, even though she was so popular and at the height of her career in the mid-60s, as the late 60s came along and style started changing and music started changing, she sort of fell out of favor, especially with her look. It was quite prim, big dresses, big hair. You know, she had a more of a upper middle class accent, and you had more working class kind of musicians coming through.
And I suppose you're getting into the hippie thing as well and all that sort of thing. Let your hair down.
Absolutely. So like doing Hal David and Burt Bacharach songs isn't exactly something that would kind of really fit in. Although, again, in a certain way, it's trailblazing because The Look of Love, when she did that, is like one of the slowest
gorgeous
pop hits. It's so beautiful. And it was really different from everything else at the time.
Because you forget that. You forget because they are standard songs. You can never really imagine the very first time that you hear that. Because it's just there all the time, those songs. Everybody knows them.
Mm-hmm.
But that must have been pretty amazing to be there when that happened.
I know. But then you see her all dressed like this in 1969. You can see why she may have been maybe perceived as like, she didn't really quite fit in with the times.
Right.
Do you think she's underrated as an artist?
I don't think she was then. Because she was everywhere, she was massive. But I think since then, I think we do need a bit of a resurgence because she was such a talent. And yeah, I think over time everything sort of comes in and out. But it's an album worth holding on to. It really is.
Well, let's talk a little bit about the album itself. So she got signed to Atlantic Records, which was a real dream for her. I mean, she was a massive Aretha Franklin fan. That's Aretha's label. And she had a team assembled that was replicated, the team that was often used by Aretha, which is Arif Mardin, Jerry Wexler, and Tom Dowd, the engineer Tom Dowd. And they went to American Sound Studios down in Memphis, where they started to record. And they had the great backing singers of Sweet Inspirations, led by Sissy Houston, which is Whitney Houston's mom, and the Memphis Cats, who were doing all who were the instrumentalists. And they had played with like Elvis and I think Wilson Pickett as well. So she had this amazing kind of cast assembled to create this album that she was finally going to be able to do a soul album. And Ahmet Erdogan, the founder of Atlantic, is really behind it. And then things start to kind of fall to pieces, don't they?
Well, and I can completely get this because she goes to Memphis and she's right in the middle of it. And she's looking at all these where they're sort of living legends. And she's thinking, I can't live up to this. I can't do it. And I think she did all the vocals in Memphis. And then she went back to New York and did them all again. Mm. So it's sort of Dusty in Memphis / New York. But
exactly.
Because she felt she couldn't fill those shoes. Mm. She couldn't fill the shoes that all those other people had. And so it was a real shame, but that's how much she really felt about what she did. She was very pernickety about what she did.
Yes.
And ultimately what she wanted was the album to be the best that it could be. That's, as an artist, that's what you want. And if your shyness and your feeling of inability stops that from happening, you have to do it some other way because you have to do the best for your project.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And she was a ridiculous perfectionist. I know that the Pet Shop Boys have talked about it, but Jerry Wexler basically played her 80 acetates of songs, you know, that she could record. Some by Jerry Goffin and Carole King, Randy Newman. And she rejected all of them. So then he played some other ones, basically the same ones. And then she liked them. And so, so she was really kind of a difficult person to work with. Not, I don't think, because she was trying to be difficult, but because she was hard on herself. That's what it seems like to me.
I think people get that about a lot of artists, that artists are being fussy and they, you know, they're being too precious about what they do. But if they weren't that precious, you wouldn't really like them anymore.
Exactly, you know? Yeah. The albums wouldn't
so
last.
They're a pain in the ass, but it's worth it.
They get there in the end. Well, I was going to hand you the record, and maybe we can talk about some of your favorite songs.
Well, I really love Just a Little Loving. I think that's a bit the most gorgeous start to the album. Mm-hmm. And it's just really pretty cheeky, really, isn't it?
It is. It really is.
Yeah, who wants a coffee? Who wants a coffee when you've got that?
Right, exactly. It's like the Diana Ross song, Once in the Morning.
And I look, do you know what the song that I really, really love on this this album is I Don't Want to Hear It Anymore. It's so sad. Because at first you think she's listening to the neighbours, and then you realise it's all about her. Mm-hmm. It is really, really sad. I'll have to listen to it. It's really good.
We will be listening to it. Any other ones?
Yeah, I know. Obviously, the windmills. Well, they're all really good, but The Windmills of Your Mind and Breakfast in Bed.
Oh, I love that one.
Breakfast in Bed. That is such a hard song to sing.
Why is that?
And it sounds really, really relaxed. Mm. It's just the range of it is ridiculous. Mm. But it's such a gorgeous song. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Beautiful song.
And again, like a bittersweet. There's a lot of bittersweetness on this album, I think.
I think also throughout her work in general, I would say. Well, one song we haven't touched upon is probably the most famous song on the album. And one which really kind of resurrected her career along with the Pet Shop Boys, I think, on the Pulp Fiction soundtrack. And that's Son of a Preacher Man. How do you feel about that song?
It's just one of those songs that, I mean, I think if I'd written that song, I'd just die completely happy.
Well, I think it was actually, when it was written, it was given to Aretha Franklin first, I believe. Dusty recorded it, because Aretha turned it down. And I'm sure if Aretha had already recorded it, Dusty wouldn't have, because she would have been paralyzed with fear.
Yeah, she
would. Because that was her, you know.
Well, that's singers, though. I mean, we're all the same. We're all neurotic.
You don't seem neurotic to me. But then, of course, the song's a hit, a minor hit, I should say. It wasn't huge. Not in the U.S., it wasn't. In the U.S., the album didn't do as well as she had wanted, which was really disappointing. Yeah, really disappointing to her. But then Aretha did record it. And then, of course, Dusty beat herself up, saying the way she did the phrasing was so much better than the way I did. So she was really her own worst critic.
Yeah, I think that's a bit of a disease if you're a singer, if you constantly criticize yourself, because then you get into a technical thing, which I think, if you are a soul singer and if you do sing from there, if you're thinking about technical stuff all the time, then there isn't as much soul there anywhere.
Do you hear that a lot in modern soul music, where people are thinking about the singing too much rather than the words?
Yeah, it's about singing and not about emotion. It's about gymnastics. And I didn't know, because I've always been like that about as a singer and a soul singer. You know, okay, Patti LaBelle. Yeah. Okay. But don't try and do it if you can't do it. Because it's awful.
So what do you think it is about this album and Dusty that still has such resonance like 50 years later? I mean, there's so many musicians like yourself, like Elvis Costello, like Annie Lennox, yeah. like Elton John that really laud her and love her. And what is it about her that's still so important and stays with us 50 years after this album was made?
I think that really we've got to look at the time that she was in, that was her time. And she really was a real iconoclast because she did things that nobody else had ever done. You know, for a white woman to sing like that, and it's like me, she just liked that music, so she sang like that. She didn't see anything wrong with it. And inadvertently, she made the whole world sort of sit up and go, oh my God, what's going on? So for people like me, that's unbelievable because she made me feel that, I mean, I didn't really think about it that much, but people like her made me feel that I could actually do it, that it was a legitimate thing that I could do, that people weren't going to beat me down because of it, and I wasn't doing something that I wasn't allowed. Because yeah. she sort of gave you the permission to do it, which was unbelievable in a way. So it's like, you know, someone who you completely admire saying, you can do it too, mm-hmm. which was wonderful, really.
Any final words before we listen to the album?
Only that my husband's cousin, Tony Powell, mm-hmm. who's retired now, but he used to run MCA Music and he was a big person in the music business. But he used to book clubs in Manchester. And he used to have a club called Mr. Smith's. And around that time, he knew Dusty Springfield really, really well. And he said she was one of the most wonderful people he'd ever, ever met. So sort of secondhand, I sort of met her.
That's fantastic. Well, thank you so much. Please thank give a you. Hand to Lisa.
Thank you.
You want to have a seat too?